Hello, everyone. Welcome to our USMLE prep series. I'm Megan, the social media specialist here at St. James School of Medicine. And today we're joined by Dr. Russell Heckburn. How are you today, Russell?
I'm doing well. How are you doing today?
I'm Megan? Doing very good. Very
That's
good.
Awesome. Yeah. That's awesome. Enjoying the fall weather?
The rain. The rain. It's supposed to snow in Chicago tomorrow. I'm hyped.
Oh, I'm so excited.
So excited. Oh. Everybody else in the office is like, yeah. Snow.
Yeah, Jones in. Yeah. Oh, it's fun time.
But like, we're here for the coldness. Yeah, we're good. So today we have posted a question on social media last Thursday. So today we're just going to go through it and kind of break down everything that happened.
Yeah, for sure. All right, so we can get started. So once again, my name is Dr. Russell Heckberg. The question last week was regarding an infant with So start off, once again, my name is Russell Heckberg. I'm a USMLE counselor here. I work alongside my colleagues, Dr. Chaudhry and Dr. Kinchelow. So I brought up a lovely comment to kind of introduce the topic, which is about newborn care. And, you know, it's kind of funny. That's why we don't have mid-husbands. That's why it's always midwives. All right. So it's about the strong hand, or in this case, the not so strong hand in the infant. All right. So start with a question. It's a 24-year-old woman who brings her two-day-old infant to the emergency department for left arm weakness. She states that he hasn't moved his left arm since birth. However, no abnormalities are found in the other extremities. He was delivered at 41 weeks gestation and weighed about 4.1 kilos or 9 pounds. His APGAR score was 8 at 1 minute and 9 at 5 minutes. The mother had gestational diabetes mellitus and occasionally drank coffee. She attended all her prenatal visits. What is the most likely cause is patient history. So do you have any guesses?
From what I had, picked up on social media from last Thursday, we had a good amount of people saying C.
Okay.
I think okay. There may have been a couple B's in there.
Okay.
My knowledge is correct. Okay. But yeah, we saw a couple great discussions on there going back and forth of kind of like, oh, I think it's this. Here's why. And then other people are like, aha, makes sense. Checks out.
Sure. No, I said those are good answers for sure. So to approach the question, for those that are a little more confused, like unlike my colleague here, Megan, who definitely knows, she knows what's going on.
We love an educated guest.
Yeah. So to highlight the clues in the question, he hasn't moved his left arm since birth.
Not good.
It was a late gestation, so 41 weeks. Usually we go to about 38 weeks.
Oh, okay.
And then we consider delivery at 40. So 41 is a little over.
Okay.
And the birth weight is about 9 pounds, so around 8 ounces, 13 is good, so 9 is a little bit, not too bad, but a little bit larger.
Okay.
And also the mother had gestational diabetes, so all of this to me speaks like the mother has a large baby. She was delivering the baby. I assume it was vaginal delivery because it didn't say it was cesarean.
Okay.
So it was probably the result of birth and trauma. If that doesn't help anyone, I'll just go to the right answer, which was actually A.
Oh, well, maybe I did not remember correctly.
Yeah, but I loved your confidence. I really loved your confidence.
It's an A for effort. Yeah. There's always room for improvement and learning.
And that is
why we're here today.
And that's the fun part about learning. There's always room for improvement.
There it is.
So the injury was actually C5 and C6 injury. So C5 and C6, those two nerves actually contribute to most of the nerves that control the arm.
Okay.
And I think only the ulnar nerve doesn't get contribution from those two, but everything else is there. If the whole arm isn't working, then chances are it's a C5, C6 injury. And also you have to consider how the injury occurred.
Okay.
So as I said, it's a large baby, mother probably delivered vaginally.
Mm-hmm.
It's a large baby, probably got stuck on the way out.
Okay.
And that actually leads to a condition called shoulder dystocia, which I will explain in the next slide. So what happens, as you can see, is in delivery, the child gets stuck right around where that bone is, and that's the pubis symphysis.
Okay.
So it gets stuck on the pelvic bone, and then the shoulder is just lodged.
Yeah.
If a doctor doesn't identify it appropriately, they might pull, or they might try to pull the baby out, assuming that's just normal.
Mm-hmm.
So that causes a stretch on the neck.
Oh,
and that's where the C5 to T1 nerves are. They branch, they come off right where the neck is, and they go into the arm.
Okay.
So if you cause a stretch on the top part, you're affecting the top nerves. So that's why C5, C6 was affected.
That makes sense.
As opposed to C7, C8,
T1,
most likely C5, C6. Okay. All right. And that results in the injury called Erb's palsy. And it's a nickname called the waiter's tip. Because you ever seen a waiter when they
just slide something behind me?
I don't know if you can see. They rotate their shoulder in and their and then their hands like behind them like this. Like, you know, give me a quick tip. That's what it looks like, called the shoulder tip.
Ah.
So it's actually the most common risk factor for this condition is called macrosomia, which is big baby or a large fetus. It's really hard to diagnose until after the baby's delivered, mm-hmm. so we'll realize the weight of the baby and size. Okay. But we can do ultrasounds to kind of get an estimate. We can see like the birthing canal. We can do measurements of the mom and the child and see maybe we should consider not doing vaginal to avoid this.
Okay.
But really, we don't know. It's just a guess. Okay. And we always like vaginal deliveries. It's actually safer for everyone.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
So since you said the 41 weeks is later, would it be, and if you could see like the baby getting bigger and things like that, would it be beneficial to deliver earlier?
Yep.
To kind of like counteract it getting bigger?
So usually we... doctors, obstetricians, we like to let it naturally occur.
Okay.
But if we do notice if the mother had a previously large baby, mm-hmm. or if they're getting closer to about 40 weeks and nothing's really happening, we will induce.
Okay.
So we'll do medical interventions. We might have it be in the hospital and slowly introduce certain like medication to induce labor.
Okay.
And to pretty much speed the process on.
Okay.
Because each day the baby is there, it's going a little bit bigger, and we don't want to.
It's a big baby.
So yeah. So usually when it's so dystocia, what happens is the anterior shoulder gets lodged behind the bone, and that's a problem because then if we're trying to get them out, we have to go to the posterior. So we have to
turn.
Yeah. We'll talk about how we get around it later, but I got
you. Jumping ahead.
Yeah. I got you. But yeah, shoulder dystocia, most common condition, most common cause is macrosomia, large baby. All right. So this is what the brachial plexus looks like. So as I said, up here would be the head, down there would be the body. So this is the top of the brachial plexus.
Okay.
As you can see, there's about 5 roots that lead into trunks that then divide into cords that then end up in branches.
So okay.
The 5 parts.
The steps of everything.
Thing. So and 5, 6, 7, 8, 1 leads to 5 general nerves, musculocutaneous, axillary, radial, medial, and ulnar. What I will point out is if you see C5, it goes down to musculocutaneous. C5, you follow another branch, it goes on to median. Mm-hmm. C5, you follow another branch, it goes down to the radial and even the axillary. So you see they're all
somehow.
Yeah, it all intertwines all 5. So injury to one of the roots at the very beginning can lead to problems with a lot of these nerves.
Okay.
And that's a big thing to take from it for the brachial plexus. So we have to know that. All right, and just to reiterate, there is innervation right here. There also is sensory input from the brachial plexus nerves. Mm-hmm. So axillary does around the shoulder, musculocutaneous does the forearm, the radial does like the back of the forearm.
Okay.
So there's different things. So even if someone is older and they have an injury, let's say you fell, mm-hmm. and somehow you actually were able to cause the same stretch, we will pinprick as well to see maybe there's nerve damage and see if you can move your hands and fingers. All right. So that's just how the nerves are distributed.
Interesting.
All right. So let's get to the root of the problem. So macrosomia, it's defined as high birth weight, usually over 400 gram or 4,000 grams or 4 kilos. Or over 8 pounds, 13 ounces.
Okay.
Risk factors have to do essentially with anything that would cause a baby to be large. So if the mother has obesity or high blood sugar, mm-hmm. Or even gestational diabetes, as we saw in the mother, mm-hmm. you know, that will all be a risk to the child because then they'll be accessible to all that fat and the sugar and they can store it and then they can use that as fuel to grow.
Okay.
And we don't want to have too much fuel and grow too much because
you have a really big baby.
On top of that, if a mother had a previous pregnancy with a newborn, mm-hmm. yeah, we gotta watch out for that too, because we have to see why and then try to prevent that as well.
Okay.
Also, we find gender, race, and genetics also contribute mm-hmm. To this as well, but usually it's without birthing trauma. We find that a lot of there was this report actually of like a woman that was about 7 feet 11 ounces. Ooh. Or 7 feet 11 inches, who had a really big baby, But because she was big, it was normal for that baby to be big. So while it was macrosomia, it was normal for her. So that's why, that's why I say gender, race, and genetics may contribute, but they won't be, they won't necessarily be birth and trauma because it might be their normal
size.
That's how it works. And then increased risk of traumatic insults during labor. So these are just things that happen. So shoulder dystocia, as we spoke about, cerebral palsy. If there's if there's a problem with the brain getting oxygen or blood, like a cord wrap around the neck, that could be a problem. Lacerations or tears to the mother, and that's. Clavicular fractures and brachial plexus injuries, those can occur. And the worst case is death. Takes too long for baby to come out. Yeah, that could be the problem.
There's some struggles in there.
Exactly.
Okay.
All right. So how do we manage it? You came in, you know, your baby isn't moving its arm, brachial plexus. What do we do? So what we try to do as physicians is try to prevent it from happening from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
So in the vignette, it talks about the mother having a lot of prenatal care.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we try to do. So we, in the prenatal care, we check for genetic testing, we check the history, we try to ensure that we're following the pregnancy to make sure that we're appropriate, we're making sure the mother is appropriate in her health.
Mm-hmm.
We do screening tests, ultrasounds, triple or quad screen to see for genetic, any genetic problems. Okay. We can do even further amniocentesis, which is sampling. But the most important test I will point out is a glucose tolerance test, which is a GTT. We do it around 24 to 26 weeks, and that is to assess how the mother is metabolizing her glucose.
Okay.
If she has a problem with it, it means hyperglycemia, big baby. So we try to avoid it. And also it's high sugar during pregnancy actually saw a lot of long-term problems. The mother can actually end up with diabetes going forward, and the child may have issues with hyper or hypoglycemia when born.
Okay.
So it's a lot to manage. So we just try to find it early, and then we counsel on appropriate lifestyle adjustments where need be.
Mm-hmm.
And now let's say we're delivering, we have shoulder dystocia, what do we do? So before anything else, get help. If you are by chance in a position where someone is delivering and this baby's stuck, let's say you got that far and you're still by yourself, you want to call help.
Okay.
There's no ifs, ands, or buts.
Sooner rather than later.
Yeah, let's be safe. And then there's also some maneuvers you do. Mm-hmm. As I said, you gotta go in and you gotta twist the baby.
Okay.
Yeah,
I'm like, we have a Lysol can if you would like to.
I mean, I'm not, you know, because no matter OB rotation, I've seen it happen.
Oh,
and
okay.
In the moment, you know, we understand the purpose of it. But then I was always concerned about mother. Mom, are you okay as we're trying
just
to rotate
this?
Yeah, that's all right.
Mm-hmm.
But if that all doesn't work, we can do a cesarean section or C-section. If the baby's not coming down and it's stuck, we just got to get the baby out quickly. We'll do a C-section. But as I said earlier, if the baby's super large, we do testing and whatnot, we see the baby's large, it's going to be a difficult delivery.
Mm-hmm.
We might recommend it first.
Okay.
Hey, you know, we think we should go with this approach.
Yeah. So you said you saw these in your rotations for OB.
Yes.
How many did you see? Is this like a bigger occurrence or...
So in my OB rotation, it was a heavy Hispanic and African American population.
Okay.
So we saw a lot of babies with macrosomia, heavy, large babies,
mm-hmm.
but there wasn't a lot of shoulder dystocia.
Oh, okay.
I think that's where the genetics and race plays into it.
Mm-hmm.
The anatomy maybe is adjusted to it or what have you, but mm-hmm. something makes it not a problem.
Yeah, yeah.
But usually for like tiny moms, we're very hey, you really need to make sure.
Eat some hot food.
yeah, it'll be good, you know. Some vegetables is great, take a walk or two. All right, so I'll just quickly run through the maneuvers. So there's a list of them. So there's fetal maneuvers, and there's maternal maneuvers.
Okay.
So fetal maneuvers are essentially you turn the baby.
That's what the baby does.
Yeah.
I knew that one.
There you go.
I knew that one.
So a lot of it is turning the baby, rotating the baby, trying to get the posterior shoulder out.
Okay.
So you readjust it. Because really, if you think about it, if you look at my shoulders as a male, and males do tend to are most common to cause shoulder dystocia.
Okay.
But look at my shoulders. If I'm coming out the canal, I am... wide this way, but I'm narrow front to back.
Yeah.
So if you turn me, I may come out a little easier.
Okay.
Right? So that's what we try to do with the baby. And if that doesn't work, we do the last resort, which is where we actually push the baby back in.
Okay.
And to do the C-section.
Oh,
to
get out, okay.
Right? And that is like absolutely last resort if it's a problem.
Yeah, yeah.
But we actually try to do the maternal maneuvers.
Okay.
Initially, which involves like we bring the legs up to the chest, so the hips, the birthing canal is wider. We may put the mom on her left side to help facilitate breathing. If it's a because if we leave the mom on her back, the baby might be compressed to the placenta.
Okay.
So if you turn the side, the placenta can get more oxygen to the baby.
Okay.
And one thing we also do is turn the mom on all fours because it actually makes opens up the birthing canal easier as well. Okay. So the traditional way of on your back and stirrups, we walk away from that when we face a problem. So these maneuvers are there to essentially widen the birthing canal.
Mm-hmm.
The fetal maneuvers are to rotate the baby so we can get through the birthing canal.
Yeah.
If none of that works, we gotta
do a C-section.
Yeah, we gotta cut some stuff. We really, like, I personally do not want to do that.
Yeah.
All right. But we have to if we need to, because the life of the mother and the baby. The baby, yes, but mother's life also is at risk, and we can't lose anyone.
Yeah.
All right. So everything's done, baby's born, stroller dystocia occurred, Erb's palsy. What happens? So usually babies actually recover from this.
Oh.
It's not a long-term permanent problem. Normally takes about a few months.
Okay.
I can go up to about a year or two.
Okay.
But you bring your child in to be assessed. They say, oh, it's a problem.
Mm-hmm.
Physical therapy is a mainstay.
Okay.
Maneuvers, move the arm around, you know, make sure, because if you're not moving the arm, fibrosis can occur around the joints.
Yeah.
You get stiff, the baby's stuck. So when you can't start moving, stiff arm can also lead to like disproportionate limb growth.
Okay.
So the affected arm might be shorter. So we want to make sure there's always physical therapy involved because it will promote nerve growth and will prevent joint stiffness.
Okay.
But the nerve growth would be important to make sure babies remembers how to use hand.
Yeah.
All right. And last resort, if that doesn't work, we can consider a surgical nerve graft or transplant.
Mm-hmm.
So transplant will take like a nerve from somewhere else in the body that the baby probably won't use, put there to reestablish innervation.
Okay.
But we only go to that if we don't see any progress within 3 to 6 months of first diagnosis.
So in this question, since they couldn't feel it or the baby couldn't move its arm, so that would that be more PT where it would just you would have to manually move the baby's arm?
Yes. So the mother will do that.
Okay.
So mother will coach mother daily exercises, do a couple times a day, you know, while she's taking care of the baby, just be very careful to make sure that, you know, blood circulation doesn't get cut or anything, or the baby doesn't like lying in and affect circulation.
Okay.
But yes, the mother will be doing that every day daily.
Okay.
And then after coming like weekly or bi-weekly for checkups, reporting if everything's improved. If after a few months, like, nope, nothing's improved, no wiggling of the fingers, not, you know, not slapping me away, not grabbing my bottle or my boobie to eat.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got to stop and say, well,
you may have to do something else.
Yeah, let's be a little more aggressive.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, but as I said, all in all, it's not a permanent injury. It will recover. Okay. It recovers in about 100% of all infants. Usually the pediatrician or the physician who is in charge will be very aggressive to ensure limb movement is very important for developing kids. All right. And just a quick side note, babies still have the history. So this is a 13-pound, 8-ounce baby in the picture. So you can imagine, like, yeah.
That's a big baby.
Even mom looks amazed. Good for you, mom.
She did it.
Yeah. But I went to Guinness Book of World Records and I saw like a list of like largest babies. So the largest long baby was that from giantess Anna Bates, where the baby was about 22 pounds. But she was once again that woman that was 7 pounds, 11 ounces.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So for her, it was a big baby. But, for everyone else, it was a big baby.
She's like,
another day. There's the heaviest twins, heaviest triplets, heaviest quadruplets.
Gosh.
The more babies you're having at one time, the less space for the baby to grow. So babies tend to be smaller.
Okay.
When you have twins or triplets.
I saw the combined weight. I thought that meant for one. And I was oh no. And then I saw combined. I'm like, would have been a lot.
And yeah, usually the weight will be. There's also things behind that, having twins and triplets with birth weight, but that would be another conversation. But it's good to know to be mindful of the birth weight and to try to keep it within a reasonable range. Mm-hmm. Too big or too small is a problem. And yeah. we want to make sure it's in a good range, a comfortable range, so the baby's healthy mm-hmm. and mom is healthy. And so if mom wants to have more babies, we want to make sure that she is not scared off by the first one.
Yes.
All right. And one more thing, just because today is Veterans Day in America and it's Remembrance Day in Canada, I want to wish all the veterans out there happy Remembrance Day / Veterans Day. You know, we all appreciate your contribution to our freedom and the rights that we have now. So thank you so much for that. Right. And that's it for my presentation today.
Thank you so much. I learned so much that
that was just... I hope that didn't freak you out.
No. I'm like, I'm short. I'm tiny. So I'm really hoping not.
Yeah. You know, that 24, 26 feet glucose test and those daily walks. It does
You're
going to
be there.
Yeah, it does wonders. You know, don't worry.
But yeah, no, that was great. It was wonderful explanations of everything and all the branches out there and... It's really cool. So thank you so much for taking your time to explain that to everybody.
Yeah, no problem.
And then, yes, we'll be back on social media the next Thursday to prompt a next question. And then the following week, it will fall on Thanksgiving in the United States. So we will be doing our video then on Wednesday, the day before. So we hope you have a wonderful week and a wonderful weekend. And if you're in the Chicagoland area, enjoy the snow tomorrow. Bye, everyone.